Wow. So we have some interesting developments in the solar industry that have happened over the last week or so that have really prompted us to come together, get our heads together to think about potential strategies, how to navigate potential outcomes that are coming from legislation. And this is sending shockwaves throughout the industry. So welcome, Dale, to the show today.
Good to be here.
You know, we anticipated as we moved from the Biden administration to the Trump administration that there would be some changes, a reconciliation bill that would go after the Inflation Reduction Act that was passed in 2023 and potentially gut some of the quote unquote green new scam or clean energy incentives. Right. There were arguably some of them over incentivized in that bill. We're expecting some changes leading up to the Trump administration and where we are today, but we didn't see this coming even as soon as last week.
No, we didn't. And Warren, for the most part, the industry didn't see it.
Yeah.
I mean, the industry, the information that I received did not allude anything to the extreme nature of the final amendment.
So let's go back. So even 2 weeks ago, I think what we were hearing 2 weeks ago, and correct me if I'm wrong, Dale, is that potentially the residential tax credit, the Section 25D, would sunset at the end of this year, but that the commercial tax credits would phase out over a quicker period of time. Originally, it was supposed to go till 2030 or 2032,
right,
but we're looking at those potentially phasing out until 28 or 29.
Yeah, I think 2028, it was considered to be pretty safe through that period, and then phase out in 29, 30, and maybe 31 or something like that. So yeah, there was a phase out anticipated, but it was only going to start, I think, at 28 or 29, actually.
Right. So last week on Thursday, the House of Representatives finally passed the bill with an amendment. Mm-hmm. Going into that Tuesday evening and early or Wednesday evening into Thursday, we had seen draft copies of the bill expecting exactly that, the residential credit to sunset at the end of the year. Projects need to be installed in order to take the credit.
Right.
But for the commercial tax credits to be surviving and then sunsetting earlier into 2028. And at the last minute, the amendments to get the bill passed and over the line really gutted the commercial tax credit as well in a very abrupt quick way.
Yeah, it really did, Warren. I mean, that I think the total shock was around the start of construction language that was brought into the amendment.
Yep.
Now, when they limited that to 60 days and combined it with the foreign entity of concern requirement, those two combined were pretty much a sledgehammer to the solar industry.
Yeah. So what actually, just to bring clarity here, what actually did pass with the amendment in the House of Representatives was that Section 25D, the residential tax credit, will in fact end at the end of 2025. If your project's not installed by the end of this year, you won't be eligible for the residential tax credit.
Correct.
Then when it comes to the commercial tax credit, there's really three components to it. Number one, it either needs to be start of construction within 60 days of when the bill is enacted, when President Trump signs it, or construction has to be completed by the end of 2028. They need to meet both of those requirements in order to qualify for the tax credit. And then finally, that third component of these components from foreign countries, if you want to talk about those three things and just give us a little bit of detail on those.
Yeah. So Warren, the 2028 was the easy part. It has to be built by 2028, and it's not start of construction. It's completion. The project has to be finished by 2028. That was kind of like the easy part. The 60 day window on the front end, as far as I can tell, it's calendar days. It's not business days or anything like that. So you basically got 2 months to there's an allowance called the safe harbor where you can take 5% of the cost of the project, invest that in hardware. Typically, that's what's done. Invest in hardware, and that project is considered to be started in construction. Construction has started if you bought that hardware. So companies have done that. That's been in place with the ITC for years. Back when we were doing some of the step downs, there was some of that kind of language used. That language hasn't changed. The wrinkle here is that you only have 60 days and you're talking about a 4-year pipeline. And that's 25, 26, 27, and 28. Unless you're doing gigantic projects, that is not a workable solution just in and of itself. I mean, our company, Warren, it doesn't do very much utility scale. We do a lot of, you know, 50 to 500 kW systems, which we build in a few months. Well, to look at that from a standpoint of, we've got to start construction for 4 years worth of work, even to get those contracts, is really kind of an impossible feat.
So, sure.
Very, very challenging, because sales cycles for solar are typically longer than that. So that piece is challenging. But the FEOC requirement is the wild card. And some people in the industry think that may be the most difficult piece of this, because it's a 100% FEOC requirement on the project. So you cannot use any materials that are connected to a foreign entity of concern. And that's typically four countries: China, Russia, Iran, and North Korea.
Right.
Anything connected to those. And that doesn't mean it needs to be made there. It could be a company that's based there. If it's a Chinese company and they're operating here, we couldn't use their hardware. Or it would violate the FEOC. And if you violate the FEOC requirement, then you don't get any of the ITC. So everything then becomes kind of a moot point.
And I would venture to guess that there's no mechanism in place to even certify that certain equipment doesn't have components from these four countries.
It would be really interesting to know how they're going to verify that. I mean, what kind of certifications can they get in place in 60 days to safe harbor projects? Really, really challenging. Now, if you have product that you know qualifies, you could use that maybe for the safe harbor and then deal with the FEOC later. But at the end of the day, there are very, very few projects that are being built in the United States that would qualify under the FEOC requirement.
Yeah.
Today. And the supply chain's not built to do that.
Right. I mean,
we don't have it. So
right.
That's a huge problem for the industry.
Yeah. So when you look at the impact on 48E and the commercial segment, mm-hmm. what kind of impact do you think that's going to have short and long term on commercial solar, if it were to pass in its current form?
Warren, it's going to bring the sale of new product to an abrupt halt once it's in effect. So,
right.
So you've got the 60-day window, you've got this period of time, you know, from now until 60 days after the bill, where you're going to sign some contracts. There's going to be people that are going to want to take advantage of the opportunity yet, assuming that we can safe harbor it and get the hardware.
Right.
Beyond that, I think the sale stops. We're going from a hyper-incentivized market, Warren, where there were numerous grants available. The ITC was anywhere from 30 to 50% typically on our clients, you know, with energy communities and domestic content. So you're going from that to zero. And if I'm a client and I'm thinking about signing a contract on a solar project, you'd have a hard time convincing me that I should sign it in the next couple of years if there's the potential that the ITC comes back. And we're already reading things like that, you know, that, yeah. you know, 2 years, 4 years from now, the ITC could become permanent and be put in place for renewables. That causes me to pause if I'm a buyer. I'm not going to move ahead now if I can wait 2 years and get a better deal.
Right. And that could put many solar companies out of business. Manufacturers, as well as installers across the supply chain.
Yeah. The other interesting piece is they left the manufacturing part of this in place.
Right.
And I find that completely fascinating because they work hand in hand. I mean, why would you build a factory and not be able to sell your product?
Right.
If the installers go out, they're not going to be selling product. I don't care what they manufacture.
Right. And you would think historically that when incentives are taken away, typically it's phased out to allow the market to catch up, to allow pricing to come down, right. supply chains to catch up.
Right.
And that ramp down the rug is being pulled, and that ramp down has been taken away.
Yep. The 60-day and the FEOC has just pulled the rug completely out and underneath the industry. You know, if they phase it out, here's the reality. This is the really sad part about this. I think we're going to see utility rates jump. Because they're not going to have to compete with solar, and they're going to have to build somehow. We have to get supply into our grid. I mean, we have this past year, solar was the largest contributor of new energy supply in the United States.
Yep.
If you pull the plug on that, what are you going to do? I mean, They're talking about nuclear, but you don't build a nuclear plant in a year.
No. And we've seen that across all the states where we work. Electric rates rising over the last few years.
Yep. They just went up. They're going up June 1st.
Down.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so the picture doesn't look great for commercial solar if, in fact, the bill passes in its current form.
It does not.
It does not. But arguably, it might be worse for the residential sector after 2025.
Yeah, because they don't have a carryover. Theirs is not start of construction. Theirs is finished. So you have to have the project completed.
And correct me if I'm wrong. I think I read this somewhere, Dale, that they are not going to allow installers like Sunrun and Nova to take the tax credits as well after this year.
There's some disagreement around that, Warren.
Okay.
Sunrun uses the PPA model quite a bit.
Okay.
And the language in the bill, as I understand it, does not, and I did some reading of this. I didn't read the entire bill, that's for sure. But the language does not address PPAs. It addresses leases.
Okay.
That's probably an oversight. But the question is, if the bill's written as it is the PPA a loophole? And will they still be allowed? And if that's the case, Sunrun, who does quite a few PPAs, residential PPAs, could continue to function in the PPA market if they safe harbor the hardware.
Right.
And I think that would be the plan. That's a cash drain on a company because they've got to buy the hardware. But since they own the systems anyway, long-term, they just have to find an off-taker where they can put the system on their roof.
But after the 60-day period, they lose that opportunity as well.
Yes. They would have to have all their hardware safe harbored for the projects they want to build.
Yep.
Very challenging.
It is challenging. Yep. All right. So that is assuming that the bill passes in its current form with the current amendments. And we've got a long way to go. And I think from a speculation perspective, we haven't been very accurate up until now. I don't know how wise it is for us to speculate going forward, but let's talk about what we do know in terms of where the bill is and what some of the next steps are.
Yeah, so the bill now goes to the Senate. The Senate is on vacation this week. So they come back next week. So I've seen all kinds of prognosis that they're going to spend, you know, 4 weeks on it, 4 to 5 weeks. I've seen people say they're going to try and meet the Independence Day deadline that was kind of set by the House to try and get it to President Trump to sign. But I've seen a lot of people saying that they don't think they're going to make that. They think it's going to become the debt ceiling, which is in August, as far as the deadline. I think it could be either. I think it's going to happen, I think, between now and then, now and August. And what that looks like is going to be really, really critical to the outcome, whether it has to go back to the House. You know, how much the bill gets changed is going to be really critical. And there could be other issues with the bill that also cause it to go back, you know, for another vote. But there is going to be intense pressure put on these congressmen to vote for this bill. I mean, already has. So I don't know. I wouldn't really want to be gambling on the outcome of this bill right now.
Sure. So if you're a potential customer looking to invest in solar, or you're thinking about solar, just learning about solar, and you want to make sure that these incentives stay in place, what can potential customers of ours do on their end to help try and save some of these tax credits?
Yeah, well, I mean, I've been saying this, you know, we had the USDA fiasco early in the year, Warren, with the grant and processing being held up and so forth. And now that's all cleared up and it's been fine. But I've been saying all year that this is the time. I mean, the incentives right now are as good as I think they're going to get on solar. And you can still lock it in. I mean, if people sign contracts and we get them safe harbored, commercial, I'm talking about commercial now, not residential. If we get them safe harbored, they can build that project between now and 2028. and they're good. I mean, and they'll be fine. Residential is tougher because residential, they have to be built by the end of the year. But once again, it's a matter of how quickly can you act and get into the pipeline? Because there's a permitting process, there's ICA process. They are longer for commercial than they are for residential. Residential can move pretty quickly. The challenge there is that it's not very long between now and December 31.
No.
With
No.
a lot of installers probably have full schedules, and they're going to continue to be full, and there's going to be new stuff coming in. People are going to want, to get their projects installed. We'd love to prioritize residential and be able to hold off on some commercial, and I'm sure all installers are going to try that maneuver as to how do we maximize the length of time that, our backlogs and our jobs can be installed to offset this lull that's coming on the sales side of the equation. So that's going to be the challenge. How do we fit all that together? But there is no better time than now. If you're thinking about going solar, I mean, this is it.
Yeah, absolutely. Now's the time to pull the trigger for both commercial and residential.
Absolutely.
If it's even a thought of yours, at least lock it in on the commercial side and start moving on the residential side.
Right.
What about homeowners or business owners reaching out to their senators, congressmen?
Well, we're encouraging that. We're encouraging that with our employees. We do it as a leadership team, a lot of organization, trade organizations doing that, encouraging that. I mean, it congressmen do listen. Sometimes it takes a pretty large volume of calls maybe to make an impact, but they do listen and they do care about what people are thinking. So, not expressing yourself is not helpful. Expressing yourself may or may not swing a vote in a certain direction, but it's been known to happen. It happens. So I think expressing the concerns that we have to our congressman, and I would suggest even, now it's in front of the senators, so we're focused on senators, and that. But I think the congressmen are really important too, because this could go back to the House for another vote if changes are made.
Sure.
So
Absolutely.
I think both houses are very, very important right now.
Yeah, absolutely. And I know we haven't talked much about this, and I don't know if you know the answer to this either. We've been so hyper-focused on the tax credits, but do you know, Dale, if there's any changes in the current bill to the depreciation and bonus depreciation? Does that change? Are we going to still have the same sliding down scale?
No, it actually does bring bonus depreciation back 100%.
It does bring it back to
Yeah,
100%. Okay, so that's
but
what that.
so that's that's one good feature coming out of it, but that does not offset the tax credits.
No, but it is helpful.
Yes.
Wow. Okay, there's a lot to digest here, and it's not over yet. We've still got things have to pass through the Senate and then be signed into law by President Trump. So a lot can change between now and then. It's not looking great in the current form, but so hopefully we get some changes that are in our favor between now and then.
Correct.
Well, Dale, thank you very much for your time, and hopefully we have some brighter news on the next video.
I hope so.
All
Thanks,
right.
Warren.